Hi guys, in my previous video, you can find the link in the description section below. I did talk about the unobtrusive data collection methods and the advantages and challenges of it. In today's video, I will talk about the type of data you can explore through unobtrusive methods. So what is unobtrusive research data collection methods? So just a quick definition that these are the methods of data collection in which researchers and the research process are removed from the researched. So there is no direct interaction between the researcher and the data collected for analysis. All right, so I'll give you very different examples as we go along and you will get an idea of what I mean from there. But you know, especially in qualitative research, the researcher becomes very involved in data collection. So the biases or the beliefs or the values and the perceptions of the researcher may influence the collected data. But here in unobtrusive methods, the advantage is that you are using the data which has been collected by somebody else. So you as the researcher are removed from it. So your biases are not influenced in the collected data. So let's get to know what are the different methods and what are the different types of data you will be exploring through the data collection or through the unobtrusive methods. So it might sound a bit strange, but clearly and succinctly articulating what you are after in terms of data is something that can actually be overlooked when using unobtrusive methods. So when you conduct a survey, the process of designing and developing your questionnaire demands your work through your data needs. Same is for interviewing. Question development is actually an exercise in clarifying what you think your respondents can offer. But with unobtrusive methods, because you're working with documents, records, data sets, and artifacts not produced expressively for your purpose, it's easy to skip this articulation step and take a somewhat haphazard approach to data collection. So the first type of data you will be exploring through unobtrusive methods is official data and records. So while you may have to work at getting access to it, it's worth exploring. So examples of these are international data held by organizations such as the United Nations, World Bank, or World Health Organization, national data held by many federal or national governments and government departments, example, national census data, local government data such as state of environment reports, community surveys, water quality data, non-governmental organization data collected through commissioned or self-conducted research studies, university data, which is abundant and covers just about every research problem we studied, and archival data, such as record of births, deaths, marriages, etc. So, of course, before you use unobtrusive methods, you need to assess your research question or hypothesis and ask yourself, what kind of data am I after? How will it contribute to my understanding? All right, so out of the ones that I show you today, you have to make the choice as to which one you want to use. So the second types is, of course, organizational communication, documents and records, which are generally official communication that includes but is not limited to press releases, catalogs, pamphlets, brochures, meeting agendas, inter and intra-office memos, safety records, sales figures, human resource records, client records, so on and so forth. The third type is personal communication, documents and records, which could be personal and often private communication that includes but it is not limited to letters and emails, journals, diaries, memoirs, sketches, drawings, poetry, stories, photographs and videos, medical records, educational records, household records, you know, such as bills, insurance documents, etc. The fourth kind is media and contemporary entertainment, where data here is often examined in relation to questions of content or portrayal. For example, the content of personal ads, how often male characters are shown crying, or how often sexual assaults has made the national news over the last 3 or 4 years. So data can come here from newspapers, magazines, news programs, current affairs shows, TV dramas, sitcoms, reality shows, TV commercials, music videos, biographies, autobiographies, so on and so forth. The fifth kind is the arts that has captured and recorded the human spirit and condition over the ages in every corner of the globe, making it perfect for comparing across both culture and time. So societal attitudes are well captured in paintings, drawings, sketches, photography, music, plays and films, and some more. The last category is, of course, social artifacts. And this can be quite fun, and it owes much to the, you know, way you look at it. So one is what we call is erosion, which looks at wear and tear in relation to preferences. For example, looking at how worn seats are to determine where people most prefer to sit on the train, or determining patient reading preferences by examining the condition of waiting room magazines. Or we also call it accretion. Accretion is the one which aims to understand society by examining what people leave behind. For example, looking through waste disposal bins in a hospital to see if staff are conforming with waste disposal policy, or examining attitudes to promiscuity by looking at toilet door graffiti, so on and so forth. So these are the six kinds of data you can access through unobtrusive data collection methods. The advantages and disadvantages and the challenges have been discussed in the separate video. The link you can find below. Let me know what you thought about these videos. I try to keep my videos very short because that's how my students like it. They don't like to watch long videos and they want quick answers. But if you want any more details on any of the videos that I present, please let me know. Thank you for watching today's video, and I'll see you soon with my next video. Bye for now.